Everybody, how's everybody doing? Good? Good? I had an earlier presentation, so you guys didn't have to get up as early this time. This is a more reasonable time of day. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Welcome to Photokina. Thank you for visiting us here at the Fujifilm booth. My name is Elia Locardi. I am a full-time world travel photographer. And they say that a journey of a million miles begins with a single step. But in my case, it might be a single flight. Now, what they don't tell you about a journey of a million miles is that while it begins with a single flight, it also ends with a lot of jet lag. A lot of jet lag. I've actually been on the road full-time since 2009. And since 2009, I visited more than 60 countries, flown nearly 2 million miles, and fallen asleep on nearly every type of public transportation in existence. Trains, planes, horseback, one time piggyback in New York, which is a funny story. And I travel pretty much perpetually, and I'm doing my best to get to new parts of the world. You can see that I have big areas that I still need to fill in. Now, full-time travel is really fun, and it's great to be on the road, but like I said, it causes a lot of jet lag when you're going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. So in 2012, my wife and I decided to do something a little interesting at the time, and that was we took everything that we owned, or nearly everything we owned, and we sold it all to become 100% location independent so that we could travel the world full-time. Now, if you're not sure what location independence really means, it's basically just a fancy way to tell your parents you're homeless. It's better. So if you go home right now and you say, hey, mom, I'm going to sell all my stuff and be homeless, she's probably going to be a little bit worried. But if you say, hey, we're going to consolidate all our possessions down to just the necessities and become 100% location independent, she thinks we have it all figured out. We didn't have anything figured out, but basically we left on the road. You can see that was my laptop. I basically had to throw these boxes away. We stepped on a flight and we traveled around perpetually, and we had to keep our entire lives in these bags, under 23 kilograms, you guys know when you're flying, that frustrating amount. And when you guys might see shoulder bags, roller bags, different things like that, what I see is a kitchen, the living room, the bathroom. And it's interesting, when we travel up here, you can see at the top, we like to collect things. Everybody likes to collect things. But how do you collect things from all over the world when you don't have a home? Where do you put all those things? So we decided to do something different, and that was collect our boarding passes. So what you're seeing is our storage unit where we keep what's left of our possessions, 5 foot by 5 foot. Remember, it's in the US, it's not metric. And these are the boarding pass collection that we had. And all over the world, no matter where I go, it can be an aggressive schedule. I hear this all the time, whether I'm hiking in the mountains or in the city or in the desert, people are always telling me to be hydrated, right? That's good advice, right? No, it's not. Stay caffeinated. Caffeinated. That is the way that we actually get around the world, because the mode of transportation is constantly changing, the gear is really heavy, and we're traveling like crazy all over the world, so that caffeine is really important. The other thing about being location independent, which is interesting, is your office is then the world. If you're in 25 countries a year, and often we are, we have to make an office no matter where we are, hotel or Airbnb. Now, I'd like to tell you guys that our office always looks like that, nice, organized, efficient, but let's be honest, it usually looks like this. Jet lag, frantically traveling, throwing everything on, trying to get the files to the clients, everything like that. But what's in the center of it all? That is my favorite travel companion, besides my wife, obviously. But I think I may love that coffee maker just a little bit more. I think she's going to leave me for it one day, though. So it's really fun because we actually have to stay productive. And every time we're finished working somewhere, we have to pack it up and get back on the road. So it's a little bit different than packing each time for a trip because we're actually repacking, unpacking. And that's led us to have incredible experiences. So being able to travel the world full time is an incredible experience. I've been able to do workshops and photo tours, different commission projects all over the world. Actually here, you guys see me in the center there? I'm actually the model in that project because we wanted to save money. So it turned out my friend was like, he's like, you look like a dirty backpacker. You could totally pull this off. So we propel all over the world and do some really interesting things. And what started happening over the series of the last few years is the clients started to get larger, the demand started to get larger, the presentations, different things started to get larger. And what started happening is the gear started to get a little under control. So remember those bags that I showed you before, just a couple bags? Two bags turned into three bags, turned into four bags. And when we're on production, or we're doing production with drones, for example, we might have 6 to 8 drones on the team that we're working on. How do you travel perpetually with 8 drones? But we couldn't figure it out. So last year, what we actually had to do, and we were excited about doing, is we finally got an apartment again. So after 5 years of being homeless or location independent, however we call it, we finally got an apartment, and there was this amazing feeling of being able to finally have my stuff, not only in one place, but completely safe. A few months after we moved in, we realized that maybe location independent was a little bit safer. But that's a different story. Everything was fine. This is actually one of the things. I'm a native Floridian, so we're used to these. We just call this, you guys call them hurricanes. We call it Tuesday. It's pretty much a weekly thing. So I don't want to talk too much about this. I actually want to transition to how I got started as a photographer. The basis of what I wanted to do, I wanted to travel to the most beautiful places in the world and find a way to capture them in a new and unique way. And so after I established these locations, it came to the point about choosing the right moments in time. And it's really fun as a photographer, we utilize certain times of day. And what I'll do is I'll arrive on a location early, I'll find a beautiful location. I'm sorry, I know Greece is not beautiful at all, but bear with me. Find a beautiful location, I'll arrive a few hours early and I'll set up. And I'll watch the transition of light. And in this case, this is a late afternoon. And as I play through this time lapse, you'll see there's, you know, it's obviously a little busy. Once the sun starts to set, there's some beautiful color starts happening in the sky. And once it gets a little bit darker, we start to get the lights from the city. And we get this beautiful time that we call blue hour, which I'm gonna explain. And that 4 hours of time in Santorini all ends up turning into one photograph. So I select one moment in time that I feel demonstrates the beauty of those locations. Later in the presentation, I'll get into this. It's gonna be multiple different moments in time. So this is the opposite. This is a very early morning after a typhoon in Hong Kong. And what happens throughout the morning is these lights will start to fade in the city. So we go from a blue hour until the sun actually rises. And as the weather transitions, it's a very dynamic scene. Well, what if I don't just want the sunrise? What if I want to combine natural and artificial light together? So what I'll get into here in a few minutes is when I have to use more than one moment in time and blend it into two. So what you're actually seeing here is the blend of artificial light with natural light with some simple blending techniques in Photoshop. But let's start with the beginning. That's a good place to start. That's what I hear. I jump around a lot, but let's start with the beginning. Let's understand the times of day for a photographer. The golden hours are really interesting. Golden hour happens before the sunset, after the sunrise. Essentially, it's when the sun is low in the sky. Depending on the atmosphere, we might get a nice golden quality to the light. And you can see on this side with the waterfall, the light's streaming through, hitting the back wall of the waterfall and the water itself. If I would have waited, and I did wait, another 10 minutes, the sky might improve during sunset, but what happens to the light? The light disappears. So the golden hour is all about balancing that light. And it works all over the world. You can see here, actually, a different place in Iceland. Just the tips of the mountains are illuminated. In another 5 minutes, they went dark because the sun went below the horizon. All over the world, we look for different places. This is Valensole in southern France. Every summer, the lavender fields, they're beautiful. I can guarantee you guys about this location. It is the best smelling photography destination on the planet. It's amazing. And what you're actually seeing is the first 90 seconds of light. And 90 seconds before this, there was no light. So we waited for that first light, and then after that, it became too harsh. So we're always looking for that. That's how you balance the gold hour. Now, this is 90 seconds. This is actually a few hours into the morning. And this becomes an issue where we want to illuminate everything. We want all of that light. So a few hours earlier, Mount Fuji looked beautiful. It had that first pink light because of the clear sky. A little bit later, the cherry blossoms had some dappled light on it, but they were casting shadows on the pagoda. So I had to actually go through and wait a couple hours to be able to get everything. So sometimes that golden hour will stretch into a late morning or a late afternoon. But essentially, it's different than sunrise and sunset. So in the audience here, if you guys don't mind, raise your hand if you hate sunsets. Nobody ever raises their hand. Sunsets are amazing. That's what we want, whether we're shooting cityscapes, landscapes, people, cars, anything. We want that sky to be beautiful. So if you combine a beautiful sky with a beautiful location, you can get some really interesting results. Now, I want to ask you guys, do you know what the biggest difference between sunrise and sunset is? Sunset happens at a reasonable hour. Sunrise is a little bit, we know, it's a little early for us sometimes. I prefer to only shoot sunset. But what we can actually do with the sunset, especially if we combine it when it's almost like a golden light situation, we can shoot right into the sun when we have that nice warm glow on the horizon. And in certain types of year, we can still get the light, the color of the sky, the light hitting the building, and then the artificial lights sort of start to happen. It's really beautiful. This is St. Clair's Beach, South Island of New Zealand. I'm not really sure what the Kiwis were trying to do with this. It seems like they kind of said there's an island out there, and then they gave up. But you can see we have the sunrise just before the sun comes up, and it's nice. You can actually get away with the sun being below the horizon when you have reflectivity in your scene. So in this case, I have reflectivity in the water, so it brings all of that color and light back. And it's really fun. And now these days, with the way that the sensor technology is, and we talk about dynamic range and how we had shoot in dynamic lighting environments, we can shoot right into the sun. And with a single RAW file, we can still retain all of the detail in the foreground, the darks, and the highlights. We can even see the blue in the sky and start to see that corona of the sun. So it's really fun these days. We're very lucky as photographers. But my favorite time of day to shoot is the blue hour. Now, I wrote here twilight and blue hour, but there's something really important to understand. Twilight is a vampire movie. Blue hour is a time of day. So if you're walking around as a photographer and telling people you love twilight, you gotta kind of be careful. You wanna say blue hour. And it's interesting. So blue hour is not nighttime photography. That's the important, most important distinction for blue hour photography. It happens after sunset and before full dark, or it happens before sunrise. And what you're gonna see is the blue light in the sky. Now that's ambient light, but it's dark enough where we can see artificial light from the town. So we can find this perfect harmony of blue hour where we can have natural light and artificial light together. So all over the world, I look for places where this is gonna look, you know, nice. And the nice thing about an early blue hour is nobody else is there except for crazy photographers. At night, you know, it's easier for us to get out. The other nice thing about the blue hour here is that it sort of makes a complementary color scheme for this. So we have the warm tones in the foreground mixed with the cool tones in the background. But what's really nice is you can see that this is almost lit by a single light source, but I'm still retaining all the detail in the foreground. But because there's still ambient light in the sky, we can see that reflectivity in the windows. We can actually see it on the left side of the Isaka Shrine. If I waited another hour, it would have been completely encased in black. So all over the world, we can shoot beautiful locations and take advantage of, in this case, still being able to see the details of the mountains and being able to see the beautiful Austrian architecture and some of the lights streaking across in the background there on the road. Blue hour also gives us the ability to capture things that we can't see during the day. Now, Singapore obviously doesn't run its laser show during the day, so we have to wait for it to get just at least a little bit dark or a late blue hour, but we can start to combine all of those lights with some really interesting elements like this laser show here, and obviously the reflectivity and everything on the water. Now, it's fun. So I'm in Dubai very often, taking different kinds of photography in Dubai, and this was my first experience with the fog. Now, I'm on the 42nd floor in Dubai, which is basically the basement. Like, 42 is nothing. You're subterranean. Because you can see at 42, all these buildings are higher, and you can see that I'm barely looking at the bottom third of the Burj Khalifa. On this morning, it was really interesting because it was so foggy that the lighting is kind of working with that fog. All the blue hour, the lights here are sort of bouncing off of it, and it's creating this really neat environmental sort of Blade Runner effect. So I'm always looking for interesting weather with the blue hour. And this is probably my favorite blue hour shot. So this is Tiger's Nest in Bhutan. So far in this presentation, we've gone through a few times a day. Golden hour, sunrise and sunset, and blue hour. And blue hour just means that you have to stay out a little bit later than your husband or wife wants you to because they're ready to go back to the hotel. So as long as you can convince them to stay a little bit longer, you can get the blue hour shots. This is my favorite shot at blue hour because when I was there, we hiked up in the late afternoon and I wanted to shoot it at night. I wanted to see what the blue hour was like. And I asked my friend, Yonten, who's still a great friend today, and he's my guide. I'm like, Yonten, do they light this up at night? I don't know. Well, how many years have you been guiding and taking people here? 20 years. And you live in Paro. And he's like, yeah. So do they light it up at night? I don't know. I have no idea. How do you not know? Nobody's ever asked to stay here that long. And I'm like, can we stay here? Of course you can stay here. Do they light it up? We'll see. So we just kind of waited. And then there was a point where the monks walked by. They were doing some repainting. So they had the buckets of paint and they were walking by. And I'm like, okay, you know, most people in Bhutan do speak English and they're really friendly. So I walk up and I'm like, excuse me, guys? And they're like, yes. Do you light that up at night? And they look at me and they're like, yes, we have electricity. So I was like, okay, thank you. So I stayed up there, shot it, brought it back down to the tourism board, which I was working with government tourism. They looked at it, they said, we've never seen it photographed at the blue hour at night before. And they've lived there their whole lives. So the prince of Bhutan, who's a really nice guy we were working with too, requested it. He said, I've never seen this so beautiful. Can we have a print in the royal family in the home? So we sent them a print. They tell me it's hanging in the palace, but they won't send me a selfie with it. Apparently, it's really hard to get through the royal bureaucracy of what they can take selfies with. So one of these days, maybe. But what it taught me was all I did was stay a little bit longer, and I was able to come up with something that I really liked. And it leads into some different things. It's watching the weather. The weather for me is something really important. Back in 2009, this was one of the first places that I wanted to photograph. It's an old photo of mine, but it's Meteora in north central Greece. And there's all of these old monasteries. I only had 4 days and almost no budget to do this, and it rained for 4 days. On our last day, it stopped raining a little bit, and I went up and I noticed that the fog was swirling. So it taught me that I can never anticipate what the weather's gonna do. And it's interesting because I started looking for elements like fog, ground fog, different things where you can use lighting, you can use the sky, and then you can use elements like ground fog to create something unique, something that only happens a few times a year when the weather starts to time. So even if everybody can go to this location, we can all shoot. We can shoot multiple times and never see this. 8 mornings I spent trying to capture this. I'd wake up every morning, put my camera on the tripod, turn it to high ISO, low f-stop, like f2.8, and I'd shoot, and because it was so dark with the new moon. And if I saw fog, I'd stay out. If not, I'd go back and go to sleep. 8 mornings, really early, hard to do in Italy when you drink a lot of wine at night. On the 9th morning after I captured it, I just slept, and it was glorious. But it's fun. The weather can give us some really interesting effects. And this photo has an interesting story because a few times a year, around September 2 is my favorite time, from Ponte Academia, you can capture the sun rising dead center of the canal. And it's this really beautiful thing. So for about 4 years, every year we'd go to try to get this shot over and over and over again, but it was cloudy or it was rainy or it was everything. I was getting really disappointed. One night we decided to stay and we started capturing lightning. And I was like, well, that's pretty cool. That has some potential. And how many of you guys use Reddit? You guys know Reddit, right? Reddit is like the raw internet. So this went viral on Reddit, and it got so many comments. People are like, must be nice to be able to Photoshop lightning into your scene. And I usually don't argue with people on the internet, because you guys know how that goes. So my argument was this. If I was going to composite lightning into a scene, I'd work a little harder for it. That's not composited. My mother taught me to never stay out in a thunderstorm and lightning storm. I never listened to her as a kid, and as a photographer, I certainly am not gonna start doing it now. Lightning is so much fun. So we have a very normal vantage point that we can go to, and we have something that's really unique that is not likely to happen again in that time. So it's a nice way, if you can capture something like this, you can make something that people have seen into something new. And that's what I'm always trying to do. Often it takes a lot of attempts, but when you get one, it's really worth it. And it's really fun. This is also real. I didn't composite this, so I'm past the compositing lightning joke. This is my last attempt at the fog in Dubai. I have been shooting or trying to shoot the fog in Dubai for 5 years. It happens somewhere between October to March. It can happen no times, one time, dozens of times. And every year I get to Dubai. If I arrived to Dubai on a Tuesday, everybody was like, the fog was amazing on Monday. And I'm like, that's great, guys, thanks. And I'll be here for like 2 weeks, so of course the fog will happen. And then I'd leave on Tuesday, and then I'd get somewhere else, and they'd be like, you don't understand, as soon as you left, the fog was like for 5 days, and okay, I'll be back next year. Year after year after year after year, and then finally, after I spent a month in Bhutan, I was using Dubai as a hub in March. I just booked this hotel, this is from the Shangri-La Hotel, because I wanted something nice for a few days before transit. And I was like, yeah, the fog never happens in March, you know, I don't really care about it anymore. And then of course, the day we get there, it's the fog. So it's the one time I stopped trying was the time that I got the fog. And it's really fun. So weather plays a huge role. But what I want to transition into is what I was talking about, blending different moments in time together. Now I'll explain what you're seeing first, then I'll explain the philosophy behind it. What you're seeing here, you're seeing a blue hour foreground, the Vatican, the bridge and everything, and you're seeing a sunset. So the sunset happens first, 15, 20 minutes later, then the lights come on in the city. And what that is it's a blend. And here in Santorini, for example, is where I really started playing with this idea. And I thought about it being a memory response. When we think about a memory of a place, a good experience we have, we don't think about it as a still photo. We think about it as a sequence of time or a sequence of events. We remember how the sun was hitting the horizon, dipping below the waterline. We remember how the clouds lit up and then turned pink. Smoke started coming out when they did the cooking. We remember what we smell. We remember the way that the blue dome churches looked. All of this stuff around us creates a memory, and not just in a single photograph. So what I wanted to do is to start encapsulating all of that time together so that I could try to attempt to better replicate a memory of a place. And it's really fun. So it's interesting, like here, for example, and I'll have a composite build of this where I'll show you. What we're seeing is, this is Osaka Castle during the cherry blossoms. They light the cherry blossoms up. But what we're actually seeing is 15 minutes of time. That's when the sun was setting. It was setting behind me. The sky looked really nice. But by the time the lights came on in the cherry blossoms, as often skies do in Japan, it turned flat, sort of gray and overcast. So I used different elements together. And again, in Santorini, what we're seeing is a fairly nice sky, but at that point, what we see in the before and after, we're not going to see those lights. So finding that harmony, for me, it's this harmony of natural light and artificial light. I feel like this is my comfort zone in photography. Here in New York, this is a really neat example too. This is a 30-second exposure. This is when I was working with the 23mm lens for the GFX 50S when it first came out, trying to get some shots. So it's a 30-second exposure, capturing the sunset, the streaks of the clouds, the soft water, and then waiting a little bit longer, bringing in the lights from Manhattan as well. And I have a build that I'll show you guys for this as well. But by far my favorite photo, the time blending, is this one. And I showed the version of the late morning with all of the light. This is a little bit different because it's interesting. Mount Fuji is illuminated from the right side, Trade Pagoda from the left side, cherry blossoms from underneath, and the city of Fujiyoshida from within. So there are four distinct lighting directions. One of my really good friends works for Pixar. You guys know Pixar? He's a lighting technical director. This drives him crazy, this shot. He's like, this is so much light. But it's this harmony. And I've spent years trying to find, I spent 2 years photographing this location until I felt like I finally captured what I wanted. The drama of the sky together with the lighting of the mountain, the lighting of the cherry blossoms with the pagoda. It's actually really fun. So blending moments in time is really, I love doing it. And that brings me to create the extraordinary. If we can control the light, if we have the capability to manage exactly what we want, both natural and artificial light, can we use cosmic elements? Can we start using stars, astrophotography and things? And you know this is Petra Jordan. How many people, because of Indiana Jones? When I watched Indiana Jones when I was a kid, I had to see this place. My nephew says it's in Transformers as well. I'm not sure if that's true, but apparently it's inspiring a new generation because the Decepticons are buried nearby. Petra by Night's really cool. These candles are lit every night, and then what I did after I captured that is I did a sequence of 30-second exposures to capture the star trails and then blended that together in Photoshop. I'll have more astrophotography to show you. Cosmic elements, though, are not just stars. And you can see this is an interesting thing with Santorini. So before I move on to the next one, notice how the stars are sort of intermittent. That's because we have light from the city. So if you're in New York City or you're in Dubai, you might see one star. If you're in Santorini and it's a really clear night, you might see a few. But cosmic elements are really interesting too, like the northern lights. So here's where you can find a beautiful location, and then you have to wait for the right things to happen. And what's really interesting about the northern lights is you have to have solar activity, clear skies, and it has to be the time of year where it's dark and far north or even south on the globe. So it's just something that's really interesting. Has anybody seen the northern lights? Okay, out of you who have seen the northern lights, who never wants to see it again? It's really addictive. If when you see it, you'll understand. I thought it was fake until I actually started seeking it out and photographing it. But I love this idea of being able to capture this cosmic element to things, using all of these tools in photography and putting it together and trying to create something that's a little bit different, a little bit unique. Now notice how many stars are here. This is what we call a dark sky reserve. This is the Church of the Good Shepherd, South Island of New Zealand, and it's where the National Observatory is. So if you can find dark sky areas, you can see the Milky Way with the naked eye. And what I've done here is I've stayed on location, captured the church itself, and then I've captured about 200 30-second exposures. And then what I can do in Photoshop is put those all together in layers, and all you do is change the blending mode to lighten, and everything else goes away in the star trails show through. Also notice how it's streaking across the sky. That's because I'm shooting either east or west to the celestial equator. If I shot north or south, it would look more like this. This location was the reason I taught myself. I'm 100% self-taught. I taught myself astrophotography because I wanted to capture this. I knew that we could shoot towards the Polaris and it was going to be somewhere in the scene. I also knew that if I was there in July, the fog was a good chance there was going to be fog and mostly clear. This is Mount Bromo there on the left. This is in Indonesia. Semeru's in the background. Really beautiful location to photograph. This is also the closest I've ever gotten to photographing an alien planet. And I'll share my dream with you guys. It's to photograph Earth from above. And I'm from Florida. I have friends who work at NASA. They actually did allow us to give our resumes in for the next astronaut program. So I worked really hard, put my resume together, sent it in, and nobody called me back. Turns out an art degree is not the right answer. They want science. They want somebody smart, not somebody who creates art. But someday, maybe. I keep tweeting at Elon Musk. Maybe he'll answer one day. So that brings me to the gear, because I've been using the Fujifilm gear for a long time for many different reasons. This is some of my gear that I have right now, the GFX X Pro. That's actually just the X-T2. The 3 is out, obviously. Now, I want to tell you that when you're shooting in these beautiful locations, it always looks like this. Beautiful, kind of cool, calm, no wind, no rain. It's never like that. It's usually like this. You're in a blizzard. You're scraping ice off the back of the camera, wiping down the lens, you can't feel your fingers, or even worse, it's something like this. I thought after watching a Tom Cruise movie where he drove in this sandstorm and it was this giant wave that a sandstorm was gonna be the coolest thing ever. It turns out it's like that. It's no fun. So weather sealing is so important so I can trust the gear all over the world. Not only that, it's also the dynamic range and how far I can push things. The reason that I'm shooting with the GFX 50S right now is because I'm doing a lot of fine art gallery work, and it's really important to me. Not just because of the size that I can print, but also how I can push things in post-processing. So now that we learned about the photos themselves and the times of day, let's take a look at what they seemed how they looked straight out of camera. But I want to say this. I'm a big Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy fan. And if you're a fan of that movie, you know what the book says, right? Printed big, bold letters on the front of that book, don't panic. Post-processing, don't panic. Everything that you saw is as simple as this. Raw file adjustment, exposure blending, maybe, if you need it. You don't always need it. Color and contrast adjustment, sharpening details and noise reduction. Number 4, don't worry about it if you're posting to Instagram, really. Like, nobody's gonna notice. If you're printing really large, then we have to spend more time with the edge detail and softness and different things like that. But basically, this is straight out of camera. And we have a couple things going on. Dark in the foreground, a little bit blown out in the sky. Over there to the left, you see that vehicle to the left? Chinese tour bus. Anytime there's a Chinese tour bus in your landscape, you have to get rid of it. So we have to fix the values, highlight shadows, Chinese tour bus. So before and after, a little bit of Photoshop magic for the bus, but otherwise pretty easy. Same shot in Hallstatt in Austria. We have a duck gliding through the scene. Certain things happen though when you're shooting at the blue hour. Mainly these are these reflected color. So we get the blue in the building, the blue on the roof. So what we have to do is sort of mitigate that by cleaning up these colors so we can bring those colors back out. But if you look at it in total as a before and after, there's really not much going on. Obviously the duck had to die. We had to kill the duck. Get rid of him. And then we had a few things to do, but overall not too bad. Same thing with the shot that we looked at the failed attempt for the Kiwis to build a bridge out to the island. There's a few things going on. Highlights, blown out. This happens a lot. Shadows, a little dark in the pylons, and there's a beer bottle. Yeah, it's a Kiwi weekend. You know, what are you gonna do? So you have to destroy the bottle in Photoshop, but also, most importantly, bring the shadows up to get the moss back, bring the highlights down. And that kind of brings me into the time blending. So this is telephoto shot looking towards Mount Cook. That is the road to Mount Cook. The name of this photo is the road to Mount Cook because I wasn't feeling very creative when I named it. What I wanted to do was compress this shot, shoot straight down, and then add something a little different to it. My problem was by that time at night, there was nobody driving on the road. So I had to have my friends drive back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. So similar to star trails, have a base exposure, and then this is just a few 30-second exposures with the lighten blending mode. Basically knocks out anything that's 50% gray to black, and the highlights stay on top. Really simple to do. But if we get back to this, this is the base plate, I would call it, for Osaka Castle. You can see that the sky has potential, the cherry blossoms haven't turned on yet, there's no lights. So what I'll do, 15 minutes later, lights come on. And then what I'll do, so that's one, raw file adjustment, that's exposure blending, and here's contrast adjustment. Three steps. The sharpening's hard to show on the screen, it already looks so sharp. So it's like a stage, three-stage kind of thing. If we look at this shot here, straight out of camera, this is underexposed XT2, potential of the sky. So the first thing I need to adjust the raw file, but the next thing that I wanna do is actually wait a little bit longer and then bring in the lights from the city. So we're using different elements together because I remember the sky being beautiful, but by the time the lights come on, it's flat blue and boring. So we can start to use a harmony of it. Now, this doesn't just work for cityscapes. It works for landscapes, too. This is the most common issue with landscape photography, especially when it's backlit or we're shooting into the sun. We'll have this beautiful sky, but what happens to our foreground? It gets really dark. But a few minutes earlier, you could still see light. Light was coming in. So I shot this when the sun was still up because it was actually casting light. So I used a 10-minute difference of the sun being just above the horizon, where I had the light in the foreground, and then the sun being just below the horizon where I had the sunset. So it fixes that issue. This is that same shot in Hong Kong. This is what I call the rare Hong Kong sunrise. And if you go to Hong Kong and you want to actually get this shot with the sun going up right above the river, it happens during rainy season. So if you go to Hong Kong during rainy season, don't bring an umbrella, bring a snorkel. Like, it's crazy. So 5 early mornings to be able to just see the sun, and a little bit earlier, if we combine it, if we bring the blue hour in with that, we actually get all the lights together. And again, it's really simple. It's just those 4 steps to be able to put all this together. And what you start to decide is, how much of this light do I want to bring in? How much of the sky do I want to bring in? And it becomes really fun. And this is cool too. So this is the base plate for that shot of the Brooklyn Bridge pylons. If you guys want to get this shot and you go to the Brooklyn side, this is a little past the selfie spot. You'll know the spot that I'm talking about, the selfie spot. Walk a little bit further and you get this. Base plate, long exposure, 30 seconds, but notice there's no light on these pylons because the sun already went behind the clouds. The previous exposure actually had the light. So I was able to just add the light back on the pylons. About 20 minutes later, I was able to wait for the lights to come on in the city. And then after I brought all this together, I was able to unify it with some color correction. Now, it's not just because I want to be able to control the time. I have a vision of the scene that I want to be able to capture, but I want to be able to control all the elements. So if you want to do this, the best thing to do, and this is what I do, go early, scout out the location, set up the camera, leave it in one place, because you want to make sure that everything lines up perfectly over top. But it becomes really fun. So basically all over the world, this is the Church of the Good Shepherd, and this is basically what it looks like to capture star trails. This is 200 30-second exposures all stacked together, and you can see them start to streak across the sky. So the sky looks, we could say, pretty good, right? Needs a little bit of work. How about the foreground? Not so good, right? This is selfie, 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 iPhone, iPad, 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 because everybody's out there. So we can't really accept that. So I got there early like I usually do, and I shot a base plate. Now, when you're doing astrophotography, anybody who does astrophotography, especially when it's in a dark sky area, we know that we're using settings like F1.8 or F2.8, ISO 3200, things like that, which we know deteriorate the quality of the image. So what I'll do is I'll start in a location, shoot this, this is shot at ISO 100, F8, 30-second exposure, I know it's gonna be tack sharp. So what I'll actually do is I'll take this along with this to create this. And now I know, because I've controlled all the elements, I've left the camera in the same spot, I know that everything's gonna be tack sharp and ready for large format printing. So it's really fun. And these days, I feel like every year we get more and more fortunate as photographers and as consumers looking for cameras, because right now, you can almost go to any booth and see a new flagship camera, and it's gonna have the features you want, and it's gonna have that raw power and performance that you want. This wasn't the case a few years ago. So now we have so many options in technology. I know that sometimes it can feel a little bit intimidating. You know, what do I buy, what do I use? But I don't want you guys to feel intimidated about it. I want you to feel more inspired. Now, these days when we have everything that we could potentially need to capture good images, now it's up to us to do something new with it. A few years ago, did we have flying cameras on drones? Now everybody has them, they're everywhere, it's so exciting. And when you start to travel, when you're trying to be creative, the most important thing that you can do is have fun. And I want to leave you with this, because this is one of the things I try to live by. Wherever you go, go with all of your heart. It doesn't matter what you want to do with photography or what you do with photography. What matters with what you're doing with photography is that you're always having fun. Thanks, guys.
Many thanks to Elia Locardi. And if you have any kind of question, you're more than welcome to come to the front of the stage and ask him some questions.
Yeah, so questions, I think, so the next person can set up too. We can, if you guys want, give me a minute, I'll go right over here to the side where all the cool cameras are in the case that you want to open up and play with. So we'll hang out over there. And I also want to say, if you want to learn post-processing for me, I have 3 12-hour courses where I teach everything both in the field, scouting on location, all the way through post-processing. So you can find those on my website, elialocardi.com. It starts in Iceland, and you can see we actually recreate all of these shots together from scratch. The other thing is, if you go to my website, I do a lot of talks and workshops around the world. Sign up for the mailing list if you're curious. Things kind of happen quickly, and I add a lot of things to the roster all the time. Anytime you want to contact me, feel free on any social media. You can get me directly through my website just by sending an email, and I do respond Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all of those things. So once again, thanks, and I appreciate any questions. It doesn't have to be photography related. It could be hair care related. It's important too. As soon as I pack up, I'll be right out here. So thanks again, guys. I really appreciate it.